As for the workship of the origination of peace, it will be there in room B. The session will be chaired by Dr. Munir Al-Tlali, the minister, former minister of Awqaf and Islamic Affairs. And in this room, we'll have also two subjects, peace in Islam from or in Western eyes, that will be launched very soon, chaired by Dr. Ali Rashid Noaimi, Chancellor of Al-Ain University, and Dr. Ali Rashid will chair the second session. What can academic institutions do to promote peace in Muslim societies? Now, I invite Dr. Mustafa Ceric, the former Mufti of the Republic of Bosnia, and Dr. Aref Nayed, the Libyan Ambassador to UAE, and Dr. Abdullah El-Seyid Weled, Abah, Professor of Philosophy at Nouakchott University. Please, you are kindly requested to start the first film in Islam, that is peace in Islam from a Western perspective. I leave it to Dr. Ali Rashid Naimi, the chairman and the president of the UAE University in Al Ain. Please, the floor is yours.
Dr. Taba.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim.
In the name of Allah, the most gracious and the most merciful, and praise be to the Lord, and prayers upon our Prophet Muhammad, his family and companions all. Your Eminence, Your Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, I welcome you to this evening session, and as has been introduced, into two, to be divided into two sessions. The first one will deal with the theme of peace in Islam from a Western perspective, and in which we will have with us among us Dr. Mustafa Ceric, the former Mufti of the Republic of Bosnia, and Dr. Aref Nayed, the Libyan ambassador to the United Arab Emirates, and the researcher Dr. Abdullah Sayyid Weled, Abah, who is on his way now and who will join us very soon. This subject, Your Excellencies, is very important because we live in a small world, a globalized world, and Islam has become the focal point all over the world. The mistakes of Muslims are put on the shoulders of Islam, and if a Muslim individual commits a certain act, this will be reflected on other Muslims, and will be also held on the shoulders of Islam. And with the rapid transformations in the world, and as the world becomes a global village due to the ICT revolution, it requires us to interact with others positively and to present Islam as it is, but in a language that they understand, not in the language that we suppose that they should understand it. And that's why we have chosen this subject. And I don't want to take much of the time of the speakers, and the speakers will tell you more about it, and they are expected to deal with the subject in detail through their own rich experience and in dealing with the subject. And now we start with His Excellency Dr. Mustafa Ceric, from Bosnia, who will tell us something about his own perspective on the subject. Please, the floor is yours. The name of Allah, the most gracious, the most compassionate. Praise be to Allah, and the prayers and blessings upon our Prophet Muhammad, his family and companions and followers. It gives me the pleasure to stand in front of you in this generous and hospitable country in response to a generous invitation from His Highness Sheikh Abdullah bin Zayed Al Nahyan and the United Arab Emirates government, known for its own goodness and hospitality all the times. And I'm really pleased and thankful to His Eminence Sheikh Dr. Abdullah bin Baya, who is our own educator, in fact, and who guides us on this trend, that is the promotion of peace in Muslim societies. I, of course, comes to you from the Balkan Peninsula, and in particular from the state of Bosnia and Herzegovina. Bosnia Herzegovina, if you'd like to add to it. And I had written my own article or presentation in two parts. The first part talks about the first book that was written on peace and war, was about war and not about peace, in fact. On the other hand, and from my personal experience during the war and the process of peace, and I didn't think of staying alive after the Second World War, and that I would experience a war in my own country, because all signs indicated that we were living in an everlasting peace till the Day of Judgment. And we, the Muslims of Bosnia and the Balkan Peninsula, we thought that that the era of genocide and massacres and killing had ended, and now peace, prosperity, and welfare will prevail. We had not thought of that, and we were, in fact, in the state or the position of Abel and Cain, you know, and Habil and Kabil in Arabic, or Abel and Cain in English, and that Cain, one thought of killing his brother. Abel told him, "Don't kill me. Don't kill me, because your sin and mine will wait for you on the Day of Judgment." But Cain did not understand what Abel said. From that time up to this moment, we've been living in this conflict, if it was a conflict between Cain and Abel. And I'm asking you this question: who is now larger in number nowadays? We are all brothers and sisters. Who is the largest number, the Abels or the Cains? And I say that I'm here through this invitation, because this title here, the promotion of peace in Muslim societies, each word in this slogan has its own meaning. What is meant by promoting or promotion? That peace is not free of charge, and it doesn't come by itself, but peace comes by efforts and by jihad. And I swear, and I ask you to testify on that, because I lived a four-year war under the siege and in the city of Sarajevo, and I saw with my own eyes blood and tears and wounds, and I saw the widows, the orphans, and the mothers that lost, or a mother that lost 7 of her sons in one day. And she's still alive. But this patience and this endurance comes from faith, from the belief, strong belief. All this experience and thereafter came what was called the time of peace, and which was not a fair and just peace, but it was peace, and which is still going on and lasting. Just yesterday, one of my fellows, a Bosniak or a Bosnian, took a gun and went to the police and killed a policeman and wounded others because in his mind, in his mentality, he has a memory that that policeman killed his father 20 years ago, and he was that child, or that boy was, or that young man was born on that time. That's what happened very recently in my country, and we don't know what will happen next, but due to your knowledge and your own experience and to learn more about the atmosphere in which we live, this murder that took place yesterday was described as the end of the world, or the breaking out of the Third World War, because this understanding that whatever things committed by Muslims must be called terrorism. And why? Because there are people who disgraced Islam and destroyed us with their own mentality and mindset, and therefore we should tell them here that what you are doing has nothing to do with Islam, and you never understand what you do has nothing to do, far or less, with Islam and our own doctrine and what we believe in. In fact, what you are doing will also inflict damage not only to others whom you consider as enemies and targeted them because they are not like you, but you will also inflict damage upon us as Muslims more than any other group. Why? Why? Because, my brothers, I think and I see that we live in an age in which Islam is attacked from within and from without. As for the external attack is what we call in Europe, was called the Islamophobia, and this is not very dangerous upon us. And whenever they increase or intensify their own attacks on us, we strengthen ourselves by our own faith and doctrine, because this is injustice. But the attack and the offensive that comes from within is far more dangerous to us, and we may call it as, instead of Islamophobia, we call it Islamophobia. What does it mean here? It means that they try to make fun of Islam. When the Westerns and the Europeans look at us, and we are Muslims, of course, you don't need to be non-Muslim when you see on TV that a person holds a gun or a rifle and says Allahu Akbar, and the other one says Allahu Akbar in order to attack his brother. What would you expect from those Westerns? How would you describe them, and how do they describe us? And so this attack on Islam from within is far more dangerous, and that's what I understood from this title here, promotion or promoting of peace in Muslim societies. This means that Islam cannot establish by itself, and we have to fight for promoting peace in the world and among ourselves in Muslim societies, as we are doomed to find jihad. And we have till today about the jihad against Satan and self-control jihad and the defensive jihad and other types. But that's what happens in Muslim communities nowadays. It's not a matter of the destruction of the state or the destruction of the infrastructures in the Islamic nations, but also we don't need to enumerate all these attacks or these damages. But ladies and gentlemen, brothers and sisters, we are facing a danger of devastating our own families and our own societies and our own relations, personal relations and collective relations. And also, and if you'd like to know how do we feel it in the West or in Europe also, and even in the edges of the Islamic world. You are in the middle, and we are there on the borders. And I'm talking about Bosnia here, exactly. I'm talking about Bosnia and what those who experienced war and genocide of my own nation, not because for nothing, but because they are Muslims. They said that la ilaha illallah, they are Muhammad Rasulullah. But when you see here in the center of the Islamic world, what are we going to do? What will remain for us there on the borders of Islamic states or Islamic nations? Do we have an outlet? Are we going to witness any sign of hope? Yes, we still have a hope, or we still have an outlet. I think that that's what we are experiencing nowadays. It's a kind of a plight and a kind of an ordeal, and these are the sins that we have not been aware of. And one of our sins is that we took things by ourselves, and we did not predict that peace is not something imposed or something simple, but very important, that we have to come around it and unify our ranks. Specifically, I'd like to attract your attention from Bosnia to the people, the followers of Sunnah, and especially to the scholars of Sunnah, to unify their words and to be one rank on this front line. That is the red line for us, that is for the Islamic states and the Islamic communities and families, and that is peace and security and stability for our generations to come, or the upcoming generations, or the succeeding generations that were not born yet. And before arriving here, I met a woman who lost 7 of her children, and she asked me, where are you going? I told her I was going to a friendly country. A country that supported us in our plight in Bosnia, the United Arab Emirates in Abu Dhabi. And she said, and asked me again, what is the purpose of your visit? I told her there is a meeting of the scholars of the nation to discuss peace in Muslim societies. And she said to me, and I'm quoting her words, she said, tell the thinkers and the brothers of yours, the scholars, that I have sacrificed 7 of my
capacity, his rich experience as a scholar. In the name of Allah, the most gracious, the most merciful, and may peace be upon Prophet Muhammad and his folks and companions, that great messenger, the messenger of peace and mercy, may peace be upon him and his companion. Good afternoon, and I extend my thanks for hosting us to this. I thank Dr. Mustafa Ceric for these valuable words and for focusing on peace and the meanings of peace in Islam. Since the end of the 19th century, many of the Muslim scholars have felt our needs of getting these heavenly meanings in Islam. And about the last ages of Sultan Abdul Hamid, Abu al-Huda al-Sayadi wrote a small book called The Garden of Meanings, Hadiqat al-Ma'ani, and Fi Sharaf al-Insani. And he spoke about the duties of the Muslim regarding the mercy, and the mercy is one of the greatest meanings in Islam, and we should renew the science of theology around mercy. And this forum on promoting peace in Muslim societies is an extension of a great heritage of Abul Huda Sayyadi and Muhammad Zafir Madani in the end of the 19th century, and it continues to Qut al-Qulub by Abu Talib al-Makki and al-Ghazali and the scholars of peace and scholars of heavenly mercy and peace, who have been the core of science knowledge in Islam and knowledge is in Islam. I also greet His Eminence Sheikh Abdullah bin Bai, and I am honored to have him with us in this session. In this paper, I am not going to speak about the Western view versus about Islam, but I would speak about a practical experience in which I took part, and I made sure during it a methodology on improving Islam, improving of Islam before the Westerners. That practical
that safeguarded the easiness and the content was to come and let us gather in the love of Almighty Allah. That initiative of Kalimat al-Sawa was criticized by voices inside the Muslim society, and the scholars who signed on it were accused by selling themselves to the West while Iraq and Afghanistan were under the occupation, and they were accused that they didn't take into consideration the cries of the Muslims all over the world. And some people also accused those scholars with treason, and they were accused of being agents to the Vatican, and the initiative was criticized, and some of the articles written on Kalimat al-Sawa was described as a call for Muslims to become Christians, and that message was directing a threat from Muslims to Christians. But the scholars who signed on the document did not retreat from their message, and those scholars signed the document feeling that there is mercy and peace in Islam, and the message was received with great love, as it laid no conditions, and it didn't ask for anything in return, and it didn't call for injustice, but it only and extended a hand and called for peace and love. That initiative made its effect, and there was the response of the Christian churches. Another reply came. As the University of the American University of Yale bought a full page of the Financial Times, and 300 protest of the Protestant leaders from the Anglicans signed a historic document titled "Love of Almighty Allah and Neighbors: The Reply of Christians on Kalimat Sawa." The message did not express love only, but it only addressed some of the injustices in Muslims, such as the Crusades, and they sent also a delegation. And the Muslims through the Taba institution sent a congratulation to the an unprecedented congratulation to the Christians on the Christmas in 2007, and a message was. There were many replies, and the best way to read these messages was the website www.commonword.com. That official website of Kalimat al-Sawa
presents a general idea of the initiative on the reflection of the goodness affected by that message,
and complete environment of initiatives were held, and important conferences were held in Cambridge University and Yale University and Georgetown University and the Vatican. And when we look at the success of that initiative, we have to learn from the success stories. Among these elements of success is faithfulness, as His Highness Ghazi bin Muhammad
were all intending to serve Almighty Allah and humanity by calling for the love of Almighty Allah and the neighbors. And by spreading this love, and Almighty Allah has offered that initiative the blessing. And secondly, the links of love and fraternity and friendship, and during the spread of the initiative, which of provided it with the protection, these links covered friendships between Muslims and Muslims and non-Muslims, as the friendship of love have offered a ground to plant the seeds of love and friendship and peace after the initiative of Kalima Tesawa, which was held between Prince Ghazi bin Muhammad and His Eminence Abdullah bin Bayya and Al-Habib Jufri and the Mufti Ahmed Ali Jum'a and Al-Buti and Al-Habib Umar bin Muhammad and Mufti Mustafa Ceric and Professor Sayyid Hussein Nasr and Ustad Ibrahim Kalin and Sheikh Yahya Bulushini and the links of friendship with Professor Bradford and his relationship with others and like Paul Wolf from Yale and George Joyam from Georgetown were so vital to strengthen these links. And it was the same with the links of friendship such as Cardinal Kralik and Father Abdab Magigin and Reverend Red, and especially in the hard beginnings. And it also the links of friendship provided a lot of help to the scholars, Muslim scholars, and the Christian leaders. And in addition to that, when that initiative promoted the Kalimat al-Sawa, and it also helped to spread these friendships and new links of friendship grow through conferences and workshops and press conferences, and the relationships with friendship with journalists like Tom Hennigan's contributed to the success of the initiative of Kalimat al-Sawa. The growth of these friendships is considered as a gift from Almighty Allah, and it is. And this is revealed in methods that are not expected easily. And the same is applied on the track and the institutional role of building these bridges, as these initiatives are built and would help to strengthen these friendships between Muslim and Christian leaders. And I attended two of these symposia, and many of these Muslim participants delivered lectures which prepared for the replies for that initiative, and the Cambridge program for dialogue between religions was another initiative. It has achieved a lot, and the friendships with those taking part in that program was effective. And among the best friends was Sheikh Abdul Hakim Murad, whom the UAE offered him the Medal of Sheikh Zayed in his chair of Islamic Studies in Cambridge University. At that time, there was a good effect on rendering the initiative of Kalimat Sawa a success, as Sheikh Abdul Hamid chaired the first delegation to the Vatican, and the conference was held, and the forum was held in 2008 in Amman and in Rome last year.
year to hold a series of discussions, of frank discussions, to end with an important meeting with Benedict XVI, when he delivered a good speech that contributed to reform and repair the friendships between Muslims and Christians. And Abdul Hakim Murad also played a good role in establishing the new faculties and universities. And here we see the role of the UAE continuing through the promotion of these activities in the Muslim, by promoting peace in the Muslim societies, led by the leaders and wise men of the Muslim society, headed by His Eminence Sheikh Ahmed Tayyib and His Eminence Ali bin Bai. And during these years, the Muslim institutions that promoted the dialogue with the Christian leaders have been also effective. And Al-Azhar al-Sharif, which has led many dialogue initiatives and has taken important steps to qualify and to prepare new other leaders and of Muslim scholars. And new other institutions in Amman are also taking part in that effort, and in Al-Habib Ali Al-Jafri, who established the Taba Institution, managed to spread the wisdom, and the former Mufti of Egypt, Ali Jum'a, in coordination with other leaders such as Osama Muhammad Al-Seyid, managed to establish a new institution, and the Mufti, with the help of his students, revived the circles and the meetings of the religious meetings, and the Al-Azhar is contributing to spread the Islam of peace and friendship. All the formerly mentioned efforts might look ineffective, but this long-term institutional work would help to establish the initiatives that achieves and materialize the word assalamu alaikum. And one of the most important factors of spreading a good picture of Islam is to build friendships, personal friendship between the leaders of various religions, to build institutions and to graduate young leaders, and to establish the infrastructure to contain the plights and seditions between the various followers of religions. And this forum, which hopes to promote peace in the Muslim societies, is another step to render the initiatives a success. I pray Almighty Allah to reward those who are organizing this forum, and thank you for your attention.
Jazallah kulla khair, al-akh al-doktor Aref.
Thank you, Dr. Aref Nayed. In fact, taking this initiative shows the positive role of scholars in dealing with the issues of the nation and building bridges with others. And the third speaker in this session is the thinker and intellectual researcher Abdullah Sayyid Weled Abah, professor of philosophy at the Nouakchott University, a man who has long experience in building bridges with others, especially in the cultural field and the vision of others or the perspective of others of Islam. Please proceed, Dr. Abdullah. In the name of Allah, the merciful, the compassionate, thank you, Dr. Ali. I start with the gratitude to Sheikh Abdullah bin Bayya for giving me this opportunity in this blessed gathering, in fact. And I I'm not specialist in fiqh or Islamic studies, but I wanted today to talk about another subject of establishing peace, that is the philosophic studies in dialogues between the philosophers of Enlightenment and the philosophers of contemporary world on the subject of peace. I start with the reference to the fact that the scholar Abdullah bin Bayya last year in his framework paper referred to a book, and that book is still read at a large scale, that is Immanuel Kant's Towards Eternal Peace. This book, which was listed in a wide scale dialogue in the 18th century regarding eternal peace, which started with a letter by a Christian clergyman, Saint-Père, Charles-Émile de Saint-Père, on eternal or everlasting peace in Europe, 1713. That priest or that clergyman at that time, after centuries of bloody disputes and conflicts in Europe, furious and fierce religious conflicts, ending them in 1648 among the European nations, that signed the treaty at that time, and this project centered around a simple idea, that is the sorting out of the problem among Europeans is not a matter of balance of powers, but also through some sort of federalism among the European nations to safeguard a permanent peace among these nations. That project presented by de Saint-Père raised many of the controversies in which everybody, all philosophers received the letter and participated in that debate, and thus we wanted to cover these aspects, but I wanted to talk about the reaction to this letter, starting from two big names in the Enlightenment philosophy, that is the German Immanuel Kant and the Swiss or the Genevian Jean-Jacques Rousseau. And what is the most important thing is to give a summary of was not to give a summary of their own ideas, but I wanted to know how did they present these main ideas in their relations with the difficulties in modern philosophy, starting from two big names in contemporary philosophy, that is the German Habermas and the American John Rawls. And I think that these thoughts will require a kind of thinking on our own ideas to have a dialogue with others, with the others, in fact. And I wanted to focus this debate on three major themes or three major questions. I think that they directed this dialogue from the 18th century up to date, that is the establishment or the legal establishment of the idea of everlasting peace, starting from three problematic questions. Will eternal peace be done through the adoption of the democratic liberal system, and therefore the liberal democracies are peaceful and peace calling, and thus they will end wars and violence, starting from this internal option? Or will the option by establishing a kind of an international legal framework, which will have a kind of a collective civil contract that is similar to the individual contract, which sorted out the problem of violence? Or are we going to go beyond the sovereign state concept as through what is called the cosmopolitan system as Descartes described it? Now I start with the first problematic issue, the relationship between internal peace and the external relations. Now the liberal thought thing thinks that democracies are peaceful and pacifist, and that democracy is a precondition for the safeguard of democracy, and democracies shall not take an aggressive act against others, and therefore the adoption of an internal system that adopts liberalism and democracy as access. This was an idea that was crystallized by Immanuel Kant, and I thought that the first condition in this is that the civil constitution shall be republican at that time. It doesn't mean the political system, because he thought that the royal system is the best. But for him, the republican means the system that relies on the division of powers and adopting the civil contractual system. This is the meaning of republican, that is the social or societal contract. And he, Kant said that this constitution is will liberate people from fear and will set up a kind of a framework for debate collectively that is standing against the mentality of violence. This is the core essence of the hysteria, because John Rawls adopted the same idea in the 20th century, who thinks that these liberal systems or regimes are pacifist and they defend on defensive war, while Jean-Jacques Rousseau and Habermas also did not adopt this idea. Rousseau thought that this idea is based on illusion, that is, it is possible to have a collective contractual society, while this latter society is based on sovereignty within a certain contractual group or system that is related to the common collective will. On the other hand, Habermas, though he felt or thought that it would be a very important target, but he said that Kant did not pay attention to the liberal national concept. Was very useful in securing internal peace, but very dangerous in motivating external violence, because this will lead to wars, and all wars of the 19th and 20th centuries were patterns of war between civil war or fair wars or just wars between two brackets to liberate other nations, leading them towards democracy and liberalism or liberal systems. This is the democratic internal model, though useful and successful in achieving internal peace, but is not decisive in establishing relations among nations. This is not a new form of discussion. Why? Because after 9/11, there is a new trend in American strategic thinking that the condition of fighting terror among Muslims and the generalization of this concept of democracy, an idea that was defended by the neoconservatives and proved its own falsehood, in fact, after the wars in the region, such as the US-led invasion of Iraq in 2003. The other problem is related to international peace and the law of nations. Devant Dijon, as he says, is the law that depends on natural law. That is, international relations must be based on a legal level, and this level achieves justice and equality among nations, starting from the priority of human rights over other laws and systems. Though the natural law theory is so limited, but we find the same idea in Kant's theory. It was Kant who crystallized this idea that we have to go beyond understanding and reconciliation among states as a part of the balance of powers, but a kind of a federal system among the free states. And this is the generalization of the principle of the republicanism to be applied at the metro, at the universal level. This is not to be applied in one state, but through an alliance, which he called the Alliance of Nations, because each nation represents a state or a unique state of civility, and thus there must be a kind of distinctiveness among these nations in order to achieve that cooperation. This was criticized also by Rousseau from the same perspective, that is, the natural law is only an abstract law and has no effectiveness to bind us to do something, and therefore it is weaker than the natural law, which had that common sense of instinctual equality. And therefore, Rousseau said that the civil system cannot go beyond the limited national border, and therefore he refuted the idea of the comprehensive national relations that could be applied at the international level. This debate was renewed very recently, especially after the Cold War, when there was a challenge, that is, how to shape the new international relations in which, or in an era in which there is a kind of an objective unity among the countries of the world, and among those who saw it in this philosophy was the Jürgen Habermas, the German philosopher who requested the revival of the ethical, the universal ethical tendency raised by Kant. That is, this peaceful trend should be the new frame for international relations in an age in which the balance of powers is not the benchmark anymore. And the problem here is to specify the position of human rights. How are we going to establish a new legal system based on human rights in its own priorities in comparison with sovereignty? We do not want to go into the philosophical and legal details, but Habermas thought that we have to go the Kant beyond the Kantian federal system that he discovered in Eternal Peace, that is the cosmopolitan horizon that we will stand at the end of this paper. As for John Rawls, he explored the same problem, and he agreed with Kant on the idea of federal union among nations, but he called it the union among nations, not countries or states, thinking that sovereign states cannot be unified, but nations or peoples can be unified as from values, and or peaceful values can be unified in some sort of a contract similar to the contract of justice crystallized in his theory of distribution or distributive justice. The other point is the cosmopolitan law and its relation to eternal peace. And this idea that was explored by Immanuel Kant in his last part of the last part of his letter, and this law was limited by what is called universal or cosmopolitan hospitality, worked upon later on by Jacques Derrida, and this law of what's called the universal hospitality, or in order to embrace and host the strangers or the aliens, because the constitutions pay attention to citizens and exclude the strangers or the aliens. So, for example, the right to visit each other as human beings, and among these basics is the minimum level of respecting human dignity and the collective concept of the human universal wealth. This idea was not developed by Kant to a large extent and became one of the problems in contemporary philosophic thinking, especially by Habermas, who adopted this idea and thought that it should be re-explored. And it is the idea that could be linked with the universality of globalization, and that it may solve the problem beyond sovereign state, which was exceeded by this philosophy. And so we have to have universal institutions that go beyond the national and the international even. And therefore, we have to revise the natural law, and we find it with Joe Rose. In another way, John Rawls thinks that there is a law for nations, and that the cosmopolitan idea cannot be shaped in a political system, but should be shaped in a civil society movement at the universal level. These are the major pillars that I wanted to remind you of. Now, what I want to conclude is that the Western philosophy dealt with eternal peace through the legal paradigm, that is the civil law and the law of nations and the cosmopolitan law. And in their own transformations, they reflected the problems of internal, international structures that we have witnessed within the last three centuries. What was clear is the reconciliation or the oscillation of the system between a universal cosmopolitan trend towards establishing peace as per human rights system, which is deeply rooted in what is called the natural law. System or philosophy. So there is a kind of oscillation between this universal attitude and that of the contractual system, that is the study of the body politic here, and the nationalism that was established by nations, while the violation of sovereignty would lead to breaking out of wars. And this will take us back to the theologian, medieval theologian concept of just wars. And thus, they were changed into the maximum states of tragedies, as was mentioned by the Bosnian speaker, and to reshape the sample of modernism and modern political systems. Thank you very much indeed.
We thank Dr. Abdullah for this speech. In fact, we have another session at 6:15, and you have 10 minutes to receive either your comments or questions for the panelists. In the name of Allah, the guest, Abdul Sabur, Dean of Al-Azhar University, Your Excellency, the former Mufti of Bosnia, and you have taken us to the real world through your words, which have materialized a world that we are in need for, and you have made the proof on us to push the Muslim countries to take a unified position, because silence would no longer be acceptable. And the question is, how have those managed to establish schools and exploit the mosques in the Arab region, and how have they directed the programs and videos from
and how have the mothers agreed to handle them, their sons and daughters. And these schools have managed, if they extend in the Arab countries, have graduated these one like that Syrian child who had an explosive belt in Baghdad, and prior to implementing and exploding, his conscience was awakened, and he handed himself to the security authorities, and he was sent back to Syria. These groups have graduated that small that girl who was 7 years old and managed to explode herself in Nigeria, where she died with other innocent people. We are facing a very serious situation, and we are before dear responsibilities, and we want to transform the text to a reality. The text says that you are all guardians, and you are in charge of those whom you are responsible of. So how can we leave our children to those who would teach them the new thought of genocide and killing and violence? Isn't it our responsibility to change the text into a human being walking on the earth? Isn't it our responsibility to save these children, these young children who are innocent? Isn't it our responsibility to save our nation and our countries? Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Please just give your name and introduce yourself. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Nasr Farid, former Mufti of Egypt and member of the Supreme Organization of Scholars. First of all, I thank all the panelists. And my comment is around the topic of this session, of this forum, actually, that is promoting peace in Muslim societies. And I think that all the papers and all the sessions of this forum are dealing with the promotion of this peace in the Arab and Islamic worlds, and at the same time to achieve the international peace. And I assure here through these and through the achieving of jihad, and by achieving jihad around the implementation of this peace, I say that this peace, through the word of Islam, we will know that Islam and peace are two faces of one coin, and that Islam is a doctrine and Sharia, and it is Islam which will achieve this peace, because the doctrine of Islam with all messengers is agreed upon by all prophets and messengers, and the Sharia of Islam is a practical application of the concept of this doctrine. And so that all the human beings who are the slaves of Almighty Allah, and that peace would prevail. And this is assured by the sayings of His God Almighty, believers come under peace and do not follow Satan. This holy verse assures the jihad to achieve this peace and to promote this peace. And if this jihad is materialized, the concept of peace, which we heard from all papers, and which means the general peace, general jihad, and not the jihad of enemies, because it is a smaller jihad. As for the bigger jihad to achieve this aspect in the social, agricultural, commercial, and economic aspect, and peace and the unity of Muslims and the world at large as the objective of Islam is the real objective and end of this forum and Islam. And as stated by Dr. Osama, and said that science and peace are the two faces of the one coin, and Islam and peace are the faces of the one coin. And I say that when Almighty Allah said that, Almighty Allah taught Adam all names, so Islam as a peace is achieved by knowledge and science. Thank you. I am giving now the panelists, each one of the panelists, 1 minute to comment. I thank you, Mr. Chairman. I want to say that in order to achieve peace, we need the more power and a bigger force. We need power more than war. And the choice is ours. Either we become powerful to achieve peace and safeguard it in our communities and societies, or we fall and fail. And I am optimistic and that through this forum we will add to our powers and we would manage to achieve peace and conserve it in the Muslim societies before assuring the others that we are peaceful. Now it is an issue among us and not with others. Now 1 minute for Dr. Aref. In the name of Allah, the most gracious, the most merciful. I want to conclude with a very simple word I learned from the late Muftah bin Ali al-Ziyadi. I came to know him years ago, and he was 90 at that time. And at that time, I returned from my studies abroad, and he was in the village of my grandfather, and he was so simple, and was one of the wali of the Almighty Allah. And he asked him to show me the most important meanings of Islam. He said in his Libyan dialect, Ya Arufa, that is Arif, that whenever we are present there, whenever you find kindness, you find Prophet Muhammad, and whenever you find cruelty, you do not find Prophet Muhammad. If we take this standard, which is a heavenly standard, those who have mercy would get mercy from Almighty Allah. Whenever we get mercy, we find the real Islam. And whenever we find cruelty, we do not find Islam. And these brutal operations we watch on the TV every day, we say that these people, those who implement such operations do not die for Islam. And the Islam that we learned from our grandmothers was the real one. And the standard, and wherever there is goodness and kindness, there is Prophet Muhammad. And wherever there is cruelty, there Prophet Muhammad is no longer to be found.
In conclusion, I would like to thank their eminences, Dr. Ceric and Dr. Aref Nayed and Dr. Abdullah Sayed Abah. And I now ask you to leave the podium so as to prepare ourselves for the second session, which will continue for 1 hour. And I call Dr. Abdul Hay Al Azab to come to the podium, and Dr. Amal Fathallah Zarkashli, and Dr. Abdel Fattah Abdel Ghani Al-Awari, and Dr. Ja'far Abdul Salam, and Dr. Mahmoud.
To say so, and we start, in fact, with the first speaker, my dear brother, Dr. Abdel Hay Al-Azab, president of Al-Azhar University. And in fact, whether I am lucky or not, he will find that I am always the chairman while he is a famous name in this field. In fact, I had a paper entitled Silm and Salam, the language of Islam in closeness and relations among nations. But yesterday I found that the title was changed and I was requested to talk about another subject. So let's begin with the blessings of God. In the name of Allah, the most gracious and the most merciful, and praise be to the Lord who showed us the roots of living. And I pray and bless the best creature, Muhammad bin Abdullah, and his family and companions. Your reverence, your eminence, your excellencies, the scholars, distinguished guests, I greet you all with the greetings of Islam. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. I have to express my gratitude on behalf of the University of Al-Azhar to the United Arab Emirates. Appreciation, thanking them for their efforts to serve security and peace at the Islamic and Arab levels, international levels, in fact. And this, of course, comes from their long experience by the wise leader, the late Sheikh Zayed bin Sultan, may God bless his soul, inherited the same to the rulers of this country who moved on the same wise path, presenting goodness and give the benefit to their people and the nation. My thanks also go to Sheikh Abdullah bin Zayed, for his generous patronage of this great forum, and my thanks and appreciations to my generous Sheikh and scholar, Sheikh Abdullah bin Baya, the chairman of this forum. Coming back to the theme that is our own subject today, what can universities or Islamic universities do to enhance peace in Muslim communities or societies? A very good question, a very dear to our hearts. In fact, one of the most important contributions that Islamic universities can do to promote peace in their own communities and the world at large is to present the fruit of good graduates who carry the banner of moderate Islam, roaming around the world, spreading love and peace, talking to people about safety and security and peaceful coexistence under the shadows of Islam, so people can all be assured of this meaning. And this meaning cannot be assured by words, but by deeds, and good behavior, working to the according to the concept of Islam will lead to conviviality and dissipate fears. This was confirmed by the late Imam Muhammad Abdullah when he went to France at that time, and he said that I found Islam without Muslims there. Now we ask ourselves, why did he say that? Because he found people there working in silence to serve their nations and in love of their national or native countries without paying attention to seditions and gossip and without preoccupying themselves with minor details that are completely useless but only to waste time and effort. Ladies and gentlemen, if scholars were sincere in their mission, and if we are aware of the trust given to us by the wise Sharia of Islam, we will guarantee our children against sedition, and we will take them to the shores of safety. Sedition lies in extremism and fundamentalism, and sedition lies in that orthodox fundamental approaches that Islam warned of. God said, oh, people of the scriptures, do not be proud or extremist in your books. And those extremists will die out. And now he said, those fundamentalists means these words. And what do we want to if we bring our children upon a fundamentalism? It's the big loss, in fact, scholars and brothers and sisters. We have to focus with our own children on one target instead of branching out. That would take us away from that target. That is the immunization of the minds of our children against extremism, fundamentalism, and pride in these things. How can we do that? We can do that through exposing these deviant concepts that disrupt and disgrace Islam and implant fear in others. And this will lead also to the hatred, as hearts or human hearts tend to flexibility, peace, and security. Oh, brother Muslims, Islam came with its own moderate attitude and forgiveful principles to establish great principles that mankind will accept it by its own sound instinct and its own human mercy. And these principles and values were the main force or locomotives of the cooperation of international societies. Oh, people, we have created thee as males and females with you, nations and tribes, in order to know each other. The most respected is the most pious, and thus this is the value. And good neighborhood is a principle and value, and tolerance and forgiveness is a value, and peace and security is a value. These are values and principles carried by Islam to mankind. Now, Al-Azhar Sharif, God has prepared this Al-Azhar to launch through its own university, old established university, to carry the message of moderate Islam and tolerance and carrying peace to the whole world, and lived for centuries and days and years facing difficulties, and it remained and will remain protective of the moderate attitude of Islam and a preserver of the values of the nation, preoccupied with the concerns of the nation without being detached therefrom. Yes, the Al-Azhar mission came from the words of Allah, and thus we made you a moderate or a middle side nation to be witnesses on the nations, and there is no embarrassment in your religion and from the statement of the Prophet Muhammad, I was sent to be a facilitator, and I was sent with the tolerant Hanifiyya or Hanifa Islam, and from these verses and from these sayings and other sources that spring or lead to hope and mercy in the psyches of all people, and through this pure tradition, abstract from any alien things, and the Azhar message came, and the University of Al-Azhar came to carry this message in its own programs and for invitation and education, and its curricula and syllabus included all this enlightened thought, while it embraces more than 500,000 students from the different colleges in the university that came to 70 colleges, all of them in the host of the university, and the university in the lap of the Azhar Sharif. We have taken this approach, and this approach taking us that taking us, and thus we also provide services, and this was a good advantage to unite the hearts of people and to believe in moderate and to protect them against extremism. Yes, Al-Azhar opened its doors for the students of science from all over the world to join the university and to take the flow of moderate science from the Sharia and knowledge, and the Sharia that includes the right concept of religion and the facility and easiness of the Sharia. Yes, the university moved ahead behind the wise leadership of the leader of moderate, the eminence of the Grand Imam, Dr. Ahmed Al-Tayyib, the Sheikh of Al-Azhar. May God bless him. And thus we started to renew the ideas and programs. Here we have the product, and here we have the fruit. The Azhar prepares minds, and the result of this university is an honor to our people who graduate from this university everywhere in every corner of the world. Yes. Yes, insisting on this moderate attitude led to the graduation of great names, and we are proud of our names and ambassadors. Now we have the International Association of the Alumni of Al-Azhar, and thus it became the platform of communication among its own alumni, those who work all over the world. Peace is the bridge of communication, and love, tolerance, and forgiveness will establish this close relations among nations. Please teach it to your students and give these lessons and spread them among your own children. Hold lectures and forums. Are we going to talk among each other as if those who advise others to stop smoking? No, we have to live with our students, males and females, so that we will not leave them live in a loss and misled. The scholars of the nation, you have a bigger duty, and before the eyes of God, it will be a kind of disgrace unless you take the initiative. And please, oh scholars, please go to your own universities, activate your programs and the seminars that would enhance peace, and hold and organize the language of dialogue that respects the other, and also licenses the concept of interaction among nations. Give your programs that would enhance tolerance and moderate attitude, and also the concept of honest citizenship and love of nations, and the enhancement of national belonging as the country is the host, and to establish the these things now. Yes, put in your own syllabus the theories against those extremists and expose this cursed ideology and give your own ideas on fiqh instead of concentrating on memorizing it and sectarian extremism and focus on exchanges with universities. Try to reread heritage and present it in the contemporary spirit. May Allah protect you from all evils, and may Allah protect the UAE and Egypt from all evils, and all the world may be protected, and may Allah protect Al-Azhar Sharif. And I say this, and I ask God to forgive me for you and you, me included. And salamu alaikum.
دكتور الحقيقة وصلت الوقت.
Do you want to come to the microphone or I don't want to follow an Azhari with another Azhari. So I will now call on Dr. Jafar Abdussalam to come to give his speech. He is also an Azhari as well. Okay. In the name of Allah, the most gracious, the most merciful, and may peace be upon Prophet Muhammad, his folks and companion, and all his companions. Your ladies and gentlemen, your excellencies, your eminences, good evening. This is a real good occasion to find myself after a long absence in the University of the United Arab Emirates. I have spent good times and happy days with the faculty of this when we attended a conference at the beginning of the establishment of the League on the challenges facing the nation, and we have found the good hospitality and the good efforts exerted in order to achieve this. And I bet for in fact, the Arab League, the Islamic League is the League of Islamic Universities is 50 years old now, and is spreading in the Islamic and Arab world and Africa, Europe, and the various geographical areas of the world. We find those who serve the message of the League of Islamic Universities. This league has a regulation and papers and documents stating, including containing objectives, and it aims at spreading the Islamic studies all over the world. And therefore, we find in the areas where there are no Islamic universities, we find a possibility for founding new colleges and institutes that carry the message of Islam at large. I say that the message of the League of Islamic Universities, we find it aims at deepening the role of the Islamic universities and renewing the Islamic thought through those pioneers who are exerting efforts. And therefore, we have established in Vienna the fairest institution outside the Islamic world and Arab world, that is the Vienna Academy for Islamic Sciences, and in France, in Nice, France, we also established a college for humanitarian studies concerned with basically with the jurisprudence, the Islamic jurisprudence, and in Germany and in many European countries, in most of the European countries, we found we have institutions, Islamic institutions, that carry the message for the students and learners in their countries. This is about the theoretical and framework aspect of the message of the League of Islamic Universities, or LIU. The issue of peace is pivotal and is a vital topic in our message. And in fact, we are considered as a reference for many entities in regard of knowing the facts of Islam and the rules and basics and principles of Islam. And I remember that I was invited along with scholars of the LIU Geneva, who were invited by the Red Cross committee to speak about the way of Islam deals with non-Muslims. And in fact, I do not forget these happy days when we exerted huge efforts in order to brief the Europeans with the idea of Islam in ending wars. And remember that I used the Islamic conquests and the events of these conquests to us to explain the message of peace in these conquests. And the first thing I mentioned was the Badr conquest, and how Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, at the beginning of that conquest, addressing the Muslims with marvelous words, do not wish to meet the enemies, and ask, pray Almighty for healthy. When you meet the enemies, be steadfast and stand boldly before it. And so we shouldn't wish to face the enemy, but when we face and meet the enemy, we should fight boldly. And at that time, the Red Crescent Committee was concerned with the good treatment of prisoners of wars, and we know that Islam called for treating Muslim prisoners of war kindly. And in the Al-Hudaybiyah, which is a long story in the history of Islam and in the international humanitarian law, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, was prevented from performing Umrah when he went to Mecca for Umrah. And he obeyed these instructions, and he returned in the following year according to the contract and agreement. And so Muslims were agreed to come in the following year with their swords in their not held in hand. And Prophet Muhammad took that as an agreement, and it was documented in Al-Hudaybiyah agreement. After that, we find a slogan I took from the first speech of Prophet Muhammad, that don't wish to meet the enemy and ask Almighty Allah for health. And also I took from Al-Hudaybiyah agreement the saying of Prophet Muhammad, they haven't prevented me nothing that would allow me to
prevent the bloodshed, that I wouldn't give it to them. And so we call for always for preventing the bloodshed. And Prophet Muhammad endured all these hardships in Al-Hudaybiyah for the sake of the slogan of peace for which he called. They said to him, delete the title, the messenger of Allah, because if we admit that you are the messenger of Allah, we would not fight you. And he told Ali, who was writing the agreement, not to refer to that he was the messenger of God. And also they wanted also to delete the in the name of Allah, the most gracious, the most merciful. And all these conditions were provocative in that agreement. Among other provocations was that when for those who wouldn't come to who would come to Prophet Muhammad without their guardians, he would send them back. And so, but the contrary would happen, that when a Muslim would come without his guardian's will, he would not be sent back by the unbelievers. And Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, gave Dawood and left aside many of the legal rules and points for the sake of peace. And we find the same thing when Prophet Muhammad entered Mecca. And you know the details and the facts and how he announced, go, you are free to go. And he forgave all those who fought him and who humiliated him. And it was a high call, a loud call for forgiveness and for avoid any revenge. And we found that Prophet Muhammad made the people of Mecca love him and accept him and to reconcile with him. And so we find that principle in all the wars waged by Prophet Muhammad. And from this podium and from the UAE, I call to get and to take the values of peace from the Islamic charters and agreements and from the wars ended by Prophet Muhammad peacefully and wisely and with all love. I say that we should take out the values of peace and security from these facts and texts, because I have studied these texts. They represent a brilliant and a bright sign in the history of Islam. And history has not, and the world at large has not known a conqueror who would behave in the way Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, acted. So are we going to leave this away without have a look at it? We have done this in the ILIU or the League of Islamic Universities, and we spoke about the ethics of war in the Prophet history, and I followed these ethics in the battles and in the texts and all agreements concluded by Prophet Muhammad with the enemies. So are we from here? We call for taking the values of peace, friend, love, and security from the history of Islam. This is what I ask you to do. And the efforts exerted in this respect are not the efforts required so that people would know that Islam is a promoter of peace and is not a wedge of war. This matter, and I remember that I had Sheikh Wahba Al-Zuhaili with me the Chancellor of the Islamabad University, and we were four, and the effect of that meeting was marvelous on the Red Cross committee, and then the Red Cross committee sent a message to the armies in the light of that meeting, and that was so clear in the works of the Red Cross committee, International Red Cross committee. This is one. The second issue is that I call for to cooperate to write the jurisprudence of peace, as it requires a huge effort, and it is good to have some of the eminent scholars I see before me now, and I hope to we cooperate all together to produce this jurisprudence and to lay the foundations on all the ethics and behaviors regard of war. We want to take the values of peace in Islam, and we want to write a book on the jurisprudence of peace in Islam, and I also call to help us to produce a book on the constitution of war in Islam. Many of the chancellors of Islamic universities are present, and I ask them to help us in what we are about to do, and in as this would add to the Islamic and Arabic library. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Dr. Jafar Abdussalam, Secretary General of the Islamic Universities Association. Thank you. Now, I ask Dr. Amal Fathallah to give his keynote. 10 minutes, please. In the name of Allah, the most gracious and the most merciful, praise be upon our Prophet Muhammad. Assalamu alaikum. I'd like to thank you for this invitation, to thank the people of the United Arab Emirates government and the people in general, wishing them all good luck, and all the organizers of this event. Today, I'd like to talk about the role of the university in promoting peace in Muslim communities. Perhaps this may be taken from the experience of Dar es Salaam University in Indonesia. We have said that the university plays a very important role in educating its students in any wide meaning of the culture, whether Islamic culture or contemporary culture in general, so that they would not be narrow-minded, and therefore, and even in dealing with the schools of thought in Islam, and therefore we educated our students and introduced them to all schools of thought and even other theologian philosophies and even modern philosophy. We hoped from that to cultivate our students with a wide knowledge and culture. Otherwise, they would have been extremists and narrow-minded, and they would be similar to states of conflict with other students. And of course, we established training courses, whether in the field of jurisprudence and moderate interpretation of Islam, and this moderate attitude in teachings of Islam in general, because Islam prefers this moderate central attitude. And also we held and organized many courses in this field, and then we found the problem of peace not inside the university but also outside the university. Dar es Salaam Islamic University is committed to the principles of Sunnah and the public in general, and we are open to other ideas. However, there are some challenges that lie beyond our own abilities due to the influence of certain schools of thought from Islam or outside Islam, such as the liberal trends and the secular trends that prevail in the country nowadays. And of course, there are some people who would abuse Islam and mispractice Islam, and also a violation of the principles of Islam. Those, for example, the Front and other associations that attacked those enemies of Islam. But the role of our university is not confined to protests and demonstrations, but to fight these destructive thoughts in a scientific and systematic way, as we study all philosophies, modern Western philosophies, and then we criticize them and refute some of them in a logical, scientific approach. Thus, we taught our students Islamic knowledge and also ordered to give them approaches of Islamic heritage, but at the same time, we order them to get acquainted with modern philosophies and modern studies. And thank to God, we refuted these philosophies or destructive philosophies that abuse Islam and try to misrepresent Islam itself. And in Indonesia, very frankly, those who are influenced by liberal schools of thought are not the students only, but also teachers and professors themselves. And therefore, the reply is not easy to these ideas. Later on, we wanted also to expand these courses, not for only for our students, but to the community itself, because the community is also influenced by this liberal movement. And as we said, that there are some liberal movements that carry the banners of the Orientalist. And for example, they teach the historical approach. The historical approach is not to reveal truth of Islam, but to uncover the weaknesses, as they claim in Islam. For example, the Quran. The Quran is not complete, because they said Uthman compiled the Quran through political, and the Quran that fits or was collected by Uthman was burnt, and they say that this Quran is not genuine. And also, the revelation came down, that came down on our Prophet is 100% right, and that we have also the early Muslims, it was also revealed to and memorized by 50%, and then 25%. This false statement arouses the anger of some Muslims, and unfortunately, some teachers and some professors may not understand that, and they say that it's not Quran, this is an NGO, genuine, but they say also other things. There are some Muslims who are fully aware of this fact and refuted these theories, some of them repented and retreated from their attitudes, especially that in Indonesia were doing that due to the fact that there are liberal thoughts in Islam, interpreting Islam materially, and thus they misunderstand Islam and abuse the principles of Islam, and in the future we'll cooperate with the Arab countries in order to counter these abuses to Islam. And thank you, and salamu alaikum, and peace be upon you all. Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Amal Fathallah, for keeping your time and for your words. And now I have the honor to call upon Abdul Fattah Abdul Ghani Al-Awari, Dean of the College of Fundamentals of Islam at Al-Azhar University. Please try to keep to your time. Assalamu alaikum. Praise be to the Lord, and prayers upon the last messenger, the mercy to mankind, our Master Muhammad, his family, his companions, and followers to the Day of Judgment. I would like to express my deep gratitude to the United Arab Emirates. This country that hosted such an important event during this difficult era that our nation experiences. And I thank them for their hospitality and generosity. And I pray to Allah to protect the United Arab Emirates government and people, and to bless them and preserve them from the evils of all evildoers. My gratitude also goes to the organizers and to His Eminence, Sheikh Abdullah bin Baya. May Allah give him health and welfare in his lifetime. Ladies and gentlemen, distinguished guests, you are most welcome. It's not a hidden secret that the world witnesses crises, political and security and intellectual crises nowadays, resulting in mispractices and sorrowful phenomena such as takfir, terrorism, violence, and atheism, and other things. These threaten international peace and the stability of many human communities. The whole world has become threatened by entering into a kind of devastating anarchy and endless violence. Stemming from our belief in the necessity of scientific and intellectual confrontation of the deviant ideas and the owners of those misconceptions, we say that the basis of coexistence among nations from Islamic perspective is peace. And the peaceful coexistence and interaction. And if you want any evidence on that, you will find, if you go to the verses of the Quran, you'll find that war was not mentioned in the holy book of Quran, as such or just a motivation or glorification of wars at all, but it was mentioned in a description showing the great crime for those who ignite wars. See the verse which says, till the war come to their ends, and God Almighty described fighting as something hated, something obliged, something that the soul doesn't like. And God Almighty said, it was written upon you to fight, though you don't like it. And our generous Prophet Muhammad, praise be upon him, prevented us from wishing to meet the enemy, saying, don't wish to meet the enemy and pray to God to give you welfare. And Islamic history proves that Muslims didn't enter into any unjust or aggressive war against any nation. The general rule in Islam is peace, and war is an exception. And the reflection on the Sharia principles will find that jihad for the sake of God requires the presence of legitimate justifications in very limited cases that could be described as the obliging necessity when the guardian or the ruler declares jihad for that reason. Scholars, thinkers, and ladies and gentlemen, those who reflect upon the life of our Prophet Muhammad will find pages bright and enlightening, seeking peace. To prove this, when you see the delegation of the Christians of Najran who visited him to discuss with him on the character of Jesus Christ, he received them in his mosque and showed hospitality to them. And the senior delegate was named Abdul Harith, the Archbishop at that time, and they started the dialogue and the debate started, and the two teams did not reach a point of agreement. And this is a right for each party, of course. Prophet Muhammad says, Jesus is one of the messengers of God, and that he gave his soul to Mary, and priest Abdul Harith says something else. When the time was up for the prayer of the Christians of Najran, the Archbishop said to Prophet Muhammad, oh, Muhammad, because he didn't believe in his own message and he didn't call him Prophet Muhammad. Oh, Muhammad, it's time for us to say our prayers. Would you allow us to say our prayers? Look, ladies and gentlemen, what would the messenger of mercy and mankind replied? He replied with certain meanings that he brought up his people upon till they managed to spread peace in the world. And Muslim communities before this age did not recognize Muslims and Christians as they lived in love and tolerance and mercy. They shared their sorrows and joys. So the Prophet replied, of course, you can pray here in this mosque. So the Christians of Najran said their own prayers in the mosque of Prophet Muhammad and in the presence of his companions. Did the companions find any anger, anything? No. When Bayt al-Maqdis was opened and the patriarch handed over the keys to our master Umar bin Khattab, the second caliph, see this culture of tolerance and this moderate attitude, and it was time for prayers, and Umar wanted to say his prayers, and the patriarch or the archbishop pointed to a place in the church, and thus Umar and his followers said their prayers, but Umar said no. So people from our nation would say that Umar prayed here and they will dispossess you of this church. And that's why he refused to say the prayers in the church of nativity and left very happily and said his prayer. And there the Umar Mosque was built. This is the culture of Islam. This is the culture of love. This is the culture of brotherhood and fraternity, that of mercy and charity and good deeds. Scholars and thinkers and ladies and gentlemen, allow me to show to you within the remaining minutes some components of the scientific approach that we, the educators, should follow, and the university professors should follow, taking this into account, to work seriously so that they could constitute a peaceful culture and to teach their own children a tolerant, moderate approach brought by the Quran and applied by the Prophet Muhammad. These components or these constituents include the heritage and the transformed principles in a moderate way, a reasonable way. The universities should teach their own children or students to combine between the open-mindedness and the Sharia principles, and the role of the mind should not be ignored in deducting the meaning and the intentions of these principles, and we should not waste the sacredness of these texts or provisions. The human mind is like the right and sound eyesight, and the legitimate or the text is like the bright sun, and no one would dispense with. That's what distinguishes the Azhari approach and the other schools that follow the same approach as the Ash'ari theology and the multiplicity of schools of thought in Sharia and the mysticism of Junaid al-Baghdadi in ethics and morality. And we should not accept the frozen classical meaning negating the role of the mind, because they claim that we belong to the ancestors and their thoughts, and this approach refuses also to ignore the principles of the Quran under the pretext of enlightenment and renewal. The Azhar professionals and teachers are still looking with these two approaches, the revelation, the eye of the revelation and the eye of the mind, the enlightened mind. And the slogan is no controversy between the necessities of the Shara and the necessities of the mind. And also we have to diversify the sources of knowledge and also the combination between knowledge and application, and also to deduce the rules and to clarify the principles of Sharia, and striking a balance between interest and avoidance of corruption. When this approach was absent in many schools of thought in the Arab and the Islamic world. I say when this was absent, based on reconciliation between memorization and mind, new strange trends carrying the fingerprints of the enmity to as the mind, and others claiming rationality in order to enter into the fabric of Islam, some loose modernism or hated secularism. Second, multiplicity of ideas should be respected, giving them a kind of measurement and benchmarking as per the Sharia. The scientific approach should respect the opinions of others and the guarantee of the right to be different, in fact, and thus our students would accept the opinion of others and to discuss it through a scientific approach, the followers of which should have the idea of contrasting and comparing, and by giving an argument against an argument and to give an evidence against an evidence. And the different schools of thought in Islam have been there in proximity in the classrooms of Al-Azhar, and the multiple ideas have always been there in juxtaposition and discussing with each other there, and the different ijtihads and ideas, interpretations are still there in Al-Azhar yards without having any hatred, without even aggressing on each other. In fact, the Al-Azhar approach stands on equal distance. The pious sheikh who respects different ideas and different approaches, striking a balance between all these interpretations in order to reach a common ground that would refuse the contrast. Thus, the Azhar school has always been that, charged with different ideas of different schools of thought and compare between them. And this school has always been rich with the different doctrinal groups, despite they have different interpretations. And thus, the Azhar has always been planting in the minds of its students the richness and the wealth of diversity, leading to openness of the horizons and the respect of the other's opinion. And this approach opened us, I don't know, and this leads to different approaches on one theme and to oppose one point against the other. Ladies and gentlemen, 1 minute. Allow me, just 1 minute. I take the remaining points. Three, the interfaith dialogue that tries to persuade people to solve their problems. Diversity of people and the presence on this plan doesn't mean that they should go dispersed and the ties should be broken. And this doesn't mean that they enter into disputes and resort to force and violence to dominate and to control the wealth of other nations. This diversity and this difference came for more introduction, for more exchange, for more support, and see what God Almighty says. Oh, people, we have created thee of male and female and made you peoples and tribes so that you could know each other. For, yes, we give our students skills of dealing with the public through the moderate understanding of the provisions of the Quran and the Sunnah. Five, the development of the skills of our own students to understand accurately and rightly of the, and to avoid any suspicions about Islam through critique and analysis. Six, make our students acquire the potential to use the Sharia provisions to deal with contemporary issues, enabling them to have positive participation in sorting out the problems of the society and continuous interaction with their contemporary reality. There are many, many other points in my paper, but we are now besieged by this sharp time. Thank you very much for your attention, and assalamu alaikum. Thank you. Thanks a lot.
جزا الله دكتور عبد الفتاح عبد الغني.
We thank Dr. عبد الفتاح عبد الغني and I call on Dr. محمد السرار from the Kingdom of Morocco, President of the Ibn Qattan Center for Studies. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. In the name of Allah, the most gracious, the most merciful, and may peace be upon Prophet Muhammad and his folks and companions. At the beginning of this speech, I support what was said by the previous speakers in thanking the UAE for hosting this forum. I also thank His Eminence Sheikh Abdullah bin Bayya for the efforts he exerts in this respect. Your Eminence, Your Excellencies, you ladies and gentlemen, I will try to be brief as much as possible because I am the last speaker and time does not allow to speak long for long. I want to answer the question of this workshop. What can the Islamic universities do to promote peace in the Muslim societies? The answer in general, these universities can offer much that cannot be presented by any other entities. And the answer in particular depends on two elements. The first is the general characteristics of the university and the major jobs of the universities. And as for the major characteristics, and I speak from my capacity as a professor in the Al-Qarawiyyin University in Fez, I tried from my experience in that university to get the general features of the university. The general characteristics of the university as included, as you know, can be summarized in three characteristics, all taken from the name, the university. The first is that the university gathers unity and multiplicity. And it gathers all kinds of construction in the space of the university, and the multiplicity is where, due to the presence of multiple specializations in the university, this characteristic is so easy in all universities as they gather the multiplicity in the framework of unity. The second characteristic is it gathers disagreements in the framework of integration, as this is better than disagreement in the framework of diversity, as it is required from each part to And these two characteristics of which our university is unique of is to disagree in the and in this disagreeing in the framework of diversity is the best soil where the solid the knowledge is present to promote the peace. And we see the chair and the scientific sheikhdom is one of the greatest channel that allow to the transfer of knowledge from the professor to students, and therefore it has never been known that one of these of those who belong and who are one of the staff of the Islamic University in Fez, in Al-Qarawiyyin University in Fez, was never engaged in violence. The Islamic universities have inherited these characteristics, the spirit of these characteristics from the schools of knowledge, such as Al-Qarawiyyin in Morocco and Zaytuna in Tunisia and Al-Azhar in Egypt and the regular schools in Baghdad and Ahmed bin Shakhroun expressed that while monitoring the transformation of the mosque of Al-Qarawiyyin mosque in the early 50s of the last century, when he said, and then the mosque turned into a university for students. That turn and that transformation was not a turn in writing the word university, and it was not by moving from a building to another or from one place to another, or from a form of teaching to another form of teaching, but it is a change for the characteristics of structure. This is in regard of characteristics. As for the jobs of the university, and in brief, they cannot be understood except through dismantling the components of the university. The major components of the university are four. The first one is the scientific project for which the university was established, and the projects of the, and they have the higher components for the MA and the PhD and the research projects in the thesis who presented by the professors, and also the curricula, which along with the component of the structure and the and this facade is almost covering all the others, and also the qualified human staff was also is the third component, and then the space provided by the university, containing the libraries and laboratories and auditoriums, and other components known to you, and in order to invest the possible to the maximum, this paper, and starting from the theoretical narration, I will suggest the following as an answer of the question. As an answer for the question about what the Islamic universities can give to promote peace in the Muslim societies. First, to use the project, the research project, the project researches to benefit people. The university space has opened wide areas for the growth of the major issues through the tracks, the paths of formation and the topics of the theses which come under major scientific project. Most of the ideas, of the effective ideas in directing the society from the womb of theses came and were as it came as from as stated by His Eminence Sheikh Abdullah bin Bayi. And there are the labs and the formation units, and to invest and use these units to study the causes of promoting peace in regard of their intentions and means, and then establishing the scientific molds to address the knowledge issues, and in order in the frame in scientific in known scientific frameworks and in the framework of symposia and means for communication digitally, to invest the spatial area to hold such forums, because the university space is the space that hosts the most important and the most targeted audience. And this audience is capable first to enrich the discussion on the content suggested and discussed by the scholars, and is capable to carry the message further and in this especially and timely. I think ended my time, and I gave some of my time to my colleague. I thank you, and he deserves that, and I thank you for your attention. Thank you.
Jazallah.
Thank you, Dr. Mohammed Srar, for this presentation. In fact, I'd like to thank the scholars, and I'm obliged to terminate it because it's time to say the evening prayers, and tomorrow we'll have a session at 10. It will be open to all, although the subject is related to the contribution of Muslim women, and you are all invited to attend this session. And I really thank you for your presence. And on behalf of all the Emiratis, I say thank you. God bless you all. You have honored us with your own presence, and may God accept your own good deeds. Thank you very much, and assalamu alaikum.